Okay, I'd like to call this meeting to order, the joint school committee meeting on Thursday, April 7th, 2016 at 6:08. I'm Cindy Womet, Chair of the Frontier Regional School Committee, and we're going to do roll call. Judy Pierce.
Here.
William Smith, absent. Keith McFarland.
Here.
Bob Decker.
Here.
Phil Cantor.
Here.
Mary Raymond.
Here.
Robert Halla.
Yep.
Alan Lipp.
Yes.
Lynn Roberts is absent. William Marapizzi.
Yes.
And Cindy Womet here. And I'm going to turn it over to Kenny.
We'll call the meeting of the Union 38 School Committee to order. I will also do a roll call. Voting and non-voting members to start. Jan Warner.
Yes.
Elaine.
Yes.
Phil Cantor.
Here.
Ira Van.
Yes.
Carl Anderson. Doug Fulton.
Absent.
Keith McFarland.
Yes.
Gregory Goschalk.
Yes.
Maisie Shaw.
Yes.
Michelle Tomlinson.
Absent.
Right. Deerfield School Committee. Kenneth Kotovec here. Mary Raymond.
Here.
Trevor McDaniel.
Here.
David Sharp.
Here.
And Waitley is Don Skrosky.
Here.
Robert Halla.
Yep.
And Katie Edwards.
Absent.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, before we proceed to the approval of the school committee minutes, you have a packet in front of you, and it says a lot, but it's the agreement between Frontier and the Union 38, and Dr. Lynn M. Carey, for our new superintendent, and I'm going to ask Dr. Lynn Carey. Dr. Carey, could you stand up and just let everybody know who you are? So we'd like to welcome you to our crazy committee meetings. And you have this, one of very many, who's your first? You have this in front of you. I can tell you that all of the things that we talked about in executive session were agreed upon. There's very few changes. A date, Dr. Carey did ask to go to the mentoring program. We had talked about that, so we're very happy about that. And we're really happy to have her on board and excited for her and excited for our future. So it's for your reading pleasure. And if you don't have one, let me know, and I'll get you one.
The league certainly welcome you, too.
And we'll move along. So we need to approve the minutes from the Frontier Regional School Committee minutes of February 22nd, 2016, and February 24th, 2016. Kenny, you want to do that? Wait a minute. Do I have a motion? I'm sorry. You don't want to do it together?
These are the joint meetings.
Okay, so we'll do the 22nd first. Do I have a motion?
You have a motion to approve minutes.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Judy.
Yes.
Okay. Go ahead, Ken. Because we can discuss
it
together.
I'll entertain a motion for the minutes of February 22nd for the union.
Make a motion. Second.
Okay, is there any discussion from both committees, either committee? Okay, hearing none for the Frontier Regional School Committee. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Opposed? We're good to go. Can't vote, won't vote, we're good.
Voting members only. Maybe if I read, then people will know who's a voting member. Probably the easiest way for the union. Kenneth Kotovec, aye. Jameson, not here. David?
Aye.
Jan?
Aye.
Elaine?
Aye.
Ira?
Aye.
Gregory?
Aye.
Keith?
Aye.
Don?
Aye.
And Bob?
Yep.
It's unanimous.
Okay, now for February 24th, can I have a motion for Frontier?
Motion.
Can I have a second?
Sure.
Okay. Kenny?
I'll entertain a motion for February 24th, 2016 minutes for the union.
So moved.
And a second?
Second.
Don?
Ignore the sound in the ceiling.
Unless it lands on you, this is
sorry. Did you vote?
Ignore the one in the elevator.
Okay, any discussion from either committee? Okay, from Frontier Regional School Committee, hearing none. All those in favor accepting the minutes? Opposed? We're good to go.
And Union 38, all in favor? Opposed? Unanimous.
Okay, moving along. Public comment? We have public, thank you. So nice to have public. We have no unfinished business, so we'll move right along to new business, and I'll turn it over to our superintendent.
So, hello, everybody. You had piles and piles of paper in front of you. I apologize for those of you who are already printed it out, but many of you don't have color printers, so I thought it really is impactful to see it in color. What you have before you is a compilation of activities and trainings for the upcoming school year. And this is K through 12. At our last joint meeting, you asked two things. You asked us to go back and take a look at the number of days, because we currently have 30, to see if it could be done in a fewer number. You will see in our calendar proposal that we have next that we have reduced it to 25. We think we can have the same impact with a few shorter days or fewer number. And you asked us to come up with a calendar for the year, which is what we've done. And I'm not sure the order in which you have your packets, but there are, if you look at the one that's the yellow, and it should have been on the top, this is your basic overview for the school year, and it starts with September 16th. You will see as you go through it that there are color codes and keys for things, and there's backup information for those of you who would like to go into it in more depth. But for September 16th, everyone in the elementary schools will be participating with science at the Hitchcock Center. And this is PK as you walk through it, through six. At the high school level, we have Mike Anderson, who's been working with the Deerfield Elementary staff this year for differentiated instruction. Don't forget, this has been a district goal for the last 2 years. It was stated within our audits that we've had that was an area that we could address with more depth, and so we are continuing with that. And then you can flip through and you will see all of the work that's proposed. The other ones, the principals felt very strongly that they wanted to have some building-based days, things that were important to their particular faculties, things that the faculty had come to them with, things that they wanted to explore with them. So you will see backup information on that. And then you will see categories, particularly on the elementary level, that are grade level meetings. And that's the one with the squares, with the pastel. So we didn't want to just say grade level meetings without giving you some backup information as to what was actually happening in those grade level meetings. So here it is broken down by the date that was decided on for grade level and the curriculum materials that were going to go into those. Now obviously this is subject to change. Subject to change because there could be a snow day. There could be other things that occur. But I think I have to commend our curriculum directors, Sarah and Louise, for spending so much time gathering this information. They have spoken with teachers, they have spoken with principals, they have surveyed teachers to come up with this information. The one that's the dark blue and the orange is Frontier. So you will see the areas that they are going to target. So that is for your 7 through 12. I also included an email that I received from a teacher, Jen Wheeler, in first grade in Conway. She wasn't able to make it tonight, but she felt very strongly about how the professional development time has impacted her classroom, just as the teachers who were here in January spoke about it. You know, it wasn't perfect this year, it was the first year, but I think to go backwards would be a mistake. I will also tell you, when we had the targeted assistance review with the Department of Ed, who was here last month, they highlighted this professional development plan as a model for the state. They were quite impressed with this. There were other areas that they wanted us to look at. I get that. But they were quite impressed with this. So I think we've met your criteria, that it's no cost. It's actually cost savings. It's the same amount of time on learning. that we do provide free childcare. The really only negative impact, if you want to look at it that way, to the parents is that if they choose to have their child stay after school on Fridays, there is no bus service and they have to come pick them up. I think it's pretty remarkable. I've been contacted by other districts in Franklin County because they also would like to model this if they can. And I feel very, very strongly that I would like school committee to support this.
Judy, can I just ask, looking at the, I looked at the Frontier one, and can you just talk to me a little bit about how, within the subject matters, the balance is sort of developed and assigned? So if you look at English, English has presenters, some assessment, some curriculum development, there's no technology, there's no instructional strategies assignment. But then you go to world language and they have a different mix. So can you just talk to me a little bit about how that comes together?
Sure, I can talk a little bit, but I'm gonna turn it over more to Sarah to do. In particular, Gary Chadwell is the writing. There have been ongoing curriculum developments and trainings that have been taking place. So some are a continuation of what already is in place. And some are because of test results and needs that the school, you know, has seen. But Sarah can talk more specifically about it.
So there's really two calendars that dovetail into each other. So this is the master calendar. All faculty are involved in the master calendar. So for instance, when you talk about instructional strategies, differentiated instruction is going to deal or talk with about instructional strategies. So all departments will get that. Technology, all departments will get that. And then, where are the other pieces? And then there's some specific training specific to each department. So the Gary Chadwell, as Marty mentioned, is a writing presenter that's come in for years. And so what I did is I met with the departments, and I met with each department chair individually, and then they also met with their departments. We met with them as a group. And we asked them to go out and set priorities by department, because each department really does have a different set of priorities. And you see a lot of curriculum mapping in the foreign languages because they have so many. They have French 1, 2, 3, and 4, so they've got four different subjects, so they're behind a little bit on the curriculum mapping as compared to English, which got ahead on curriculum mapping. So they're all in slightly different places. But the idea is that there's specific themes that would be laid out for the year. One is differentiation. One is assessment, and the third one is technology, and those are building-wide and district-wide initiatives that everyone would be involved in, and then there would be specific department initiatives also.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Rob.
Question. And it involves the elementary level. I don't have any responsibilities. Do we emphasize handwriting at all? Improving the kids' handwriting?
Are you talking about within the professional development, or are you talking about the general curriculum?
Well, I'm saying it so it gets targeted, so these kids actually improve their handwriting.
I'm going to turn to Louise on that.
I didn't hear a word he said.
Well, I was asking if there is emphasis at the elementary level on handwriting skills.
And I asked in professional development, but I think he was thinking more within the classroom.
We have a program called Handwriting Without Tears that was started by occupational therapists several years ago in response to the fact that many children got referred for occupational therapy because of their handwriting. And so that is our district program. It's not something that we need a lot of training in, but so it isn't in our professional development calendar, but it is our program. There are worksheets, and that's our official program. Handwriting still is in the curriculum. Granted, we don't have as much time for it as we used to have, but it's still something we do teach. So does that answer?
You don't have the handwriting that we had. I would.
No, we don't. We probably have different computers than when you went to school, too.
We've advanced from charcoal and slate.
No, but handwriting, actually, not to belittle it, you know, there is research that kids who go to keyboards too soon without properly forming letters, there is what they call proprioceptive feedback to the brain from that pressure of the pencil. So it's good for children to learn to form letters with their fingers with a tool,
in addition to learning keyboarding. So we try to balance it.
I want to make sure it's not overlooked.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So there's a lot on DDM scoring as well. I was under the impression that DDM is no longer required. I was wondering why there's still the focus of taking the amount of time to do all the DDMs.
Well, I haven't heard that.
It's you're from Amherst.
We don't understand why Amherst thinks they've gone away.
They are still
alive. But as far as we all know, they're still alive and well in Massachusetts.
Yes.
And until we hear otherwise from the state, we're continuing on the course.
Schools might choose to use only standardized testing,
yes,
which we will not do. So we believe that teachers should have a voice in what measures they feel are of value to their teaching. That's why we still are using district-determined measures instead of purely only MCAS, PARC, whatever's going to come down the pike, which is going to feed into student-teacher evaluations.
Yeah, and that may be true.
Yeah.
They may be dealing
Amherst
with
might
it.
Have more
they
tests.
May be dealing it with it in a different way than we're
and,
dealing
and they,
with it.
And it is true, Keith. There has been very little emphasis. But I will also tell you, during the DESE audit a month ago, they applauded us once again for our DDMs, that they thought we were well ahead of most districts. And they are measures that we're currently using. It's not like we created, invented these things as part of our teaching practice. And I agree with Louise. For us, just to measure our district based on an MCAS or PARC score, big mistake.
So the DD, I'm wondering if it comes, I mean, it's a version of Common Assessment, which is, mm-hmm, I think, very valuable. I'm wondering if it's coming from the teachers,
yes,
in specific targeted areas,
yeah,
or if it's being
very
determined
much,
otherwise.
It's very much teacher-driven. And frankly, I have liked the DDMs exactly for what you're talking about, because they are common assessments, and it's getting the conversation started around, you know, what do all the different science classes look like when they're measuring with a final exam, and what's really valuable and important. So I agree. And I didn't mean to slam Amherst. I like
I'm sure all the people in Amherst that are watching are good. They're good.
So,
Phil?
Oh, I would just like to say thank you for cutting it back to 25 days. I hope that didn't impact the judged effectiveness of what you're trying to do too much.
Well, we're going to be, we're going to try to be more efficient. This was our first year out, and we learned a lot. And I think we can be more, even more efficient next year. So that's, we were trying to acknowledge the needs of the community, the desire of the school community, while also meeting the needs of our teachers. So that's our version of moving ahead while balancing those needs. So thank you.
And I guess the way that that's sort of demonstrated in the calendar, the early releases ending in early May,
yes,
that seems to me intuitively a good idea. I hope in late May everybody feels that way as well.
Thank you, Bill.
Katie?
So I think this is an amazing plan that was put together. It's clear having point people to focus on this is great. I was curious on the student side. You know I'm not thrilled with
I know.
The early release because I think it's great for the teachers, but it's not so great for the students. I do think time is being lost in the classroom. It's too bad we don't have more time for everything. But I was curious if there's been any more thought on what can happen during the time for the students, and if there's any, who is the point person?
What we have said, because every building, depending upon the number of students and the community, is very different, and that it really should be a building-based decision. I know, and it should go back to the principal. And I don't mean to, dump this on the principal, but there are instructional assistants who have come forward on occasion, not on a regular basis, to do some sort of enrichment plans. And we would support that, and we would support that through planning and, whatever we could financially. It doesn't work as well in some of the other schools. I will admit that. The smaller schools seem to be able to incorporate it easier than the larger schools. And while I'm sympathetic to that, I remind people that the purpose of doing this was for professional development, and try not to inconvenience families, as little as possible, and to provide something. It's only that hour and a half. It's something fun and enjoyable for kids. Now, I will also say we have been very fortunate this year that most of our Fridays have been dry and sunny. I don't know that that's always going to be that way. So the kids, in many cases, have loved having this long play and recess time. Is it perfect? I know it's, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I do also remember the aides speaking at the last meeting.
That was one person who didn't represent more than that one person. So I have to be cautious on that.
Well, I thought I remember them reading a letter from a group of aides, but regardless,
okay. Yeah.
The feedback I've heard from parents is that it's quite chaotic as some of those after school. And to your point, if there is for a short time, it could be more.
Yeah.
So I guess I would ask in the future to be thinking about how we're going to manage the student side also. I don't want my kids to just have a good time. I would like them to be learning if possible.
Yeah. But I think that does come back to a building-based decision as well. Keith?
To kind of echo it a little bit, I've talked with some parents and some teachers, and from the parent side, it was mixed. Some parents raved about the experiences their kids have had. Some talked about how when they got there, the kids were clawing to get out. The couple of things that I did hear was from teachers, you know, Friday afternoon being difficult. It's a long week.
I'm sorry, can you speak up?
Friday afternoon being difficult, it's a long week, it's a tough time. And then what surprised me was the difficulty with kids on Fridays, that they almost see it like a continual long weekend. So trying to get them up to actually do well on Fridays was a little bit more difficult. And I did hear some requests for consideration about maybe a different day of the week, possibly a Tuesday or Wednesday rather than just a Friday.
You know, when I polled other schools, because Mohawk does it on a Wednesday, and their teachers, from what I have gathered, hate it, because the reason they hate it is they get going for 2 days, and then they have to have a half day Wednesday, and they go for 2 days, and then they stop and they have two. So I think you're going to find, whenever you do any polls, as many people like something as don't like something. And I go back to, what is the alternative? And I don't find the alternative very palatable compared to what we have now. Again, I said it's not perfect. This was the first year. We haven't gone through a full year yet. And we're learning. But I think the value outweighs the negativity.
Yeah, I wouldn't say, I mean, this obviously looks like there's a tremendous amount of work that's gone into it, a tremendous amount of planning. I wouldn't advocate scuttling this by any means. And I wouldn't advocate going back to the way it was as well.
Mm-hmm.
But going forward, I would say just keep all ideas on the table, possibly considering moving to a different day of the week. The thing about the kids in school and how much, what we can get done with them or what teachers can get done with them, it's kind of the attitude that they come in with on a Friday half day. I never even considered it. I found it a little surprising.
Okay. And that actually, I'm sure that's true. It's the first time I've heard that. So, but I think, you know, as you go through things, you're always trying to improve and tweak and make it better. You've got your principal sitting right here. They're hearing all of this. I think they're going to always be looking for ways to improve the experience for kids within the parameters that they have. And you know, I don't think it's something that's static. I think it's just ever growing and ever changing. And I'm sure Lynn will do a great job.
Yay!
Best of luck.
Lynn's going to change it to a Wednesday, so.
Anybody else?
Any other comments?
Okay, hearing none, we're going to take a vote on it. So could I have a motion from Frontier Regional?
Nominate.
Could I have a second?
You have a second.
Thanks.
For the union, could I have a motion?
Motion.
And second?
Second.
Thank you.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, I'm going to do a roll call. Judy Pierce?
Yes.
William Smith is still absent. Keith McFarland?
Yes.
Bob Decker?
Yes.
Phil Cantor?
Yes.
Mary Raymond?
Yes.
Robert Halla?
Yes.
Alan Lipp?
Yes.
Lynn Roberts is absent. And Bill Marapizzi?
Yes.
And Cindy Womet? Yes. Okay.
Okay. And for the union, Kenneth Karbeck? Yes. David Sharp?
Yes.
Jan?
Yes.
Elaine?
Yes.
Ira?
Yes.
Gregory?
Yes.
And Keith?
Yes.
Don?
Yes.
Katie?
Yes.
And Bob?
Yes.
That was a long pause, Katie. So, it's unanimous. Thank you all.
Thank you.
the great questions, and thank you to the team over there for an amazing plan.
Okay, we're moving on to the calendars.
Okay.
Should we have them in front of you? Are they color
coded? Yeah. So red is the Union, and blue is Frontier. It's not a political statement, just the way we did it. They are identical except for their titles. And thank you for the approval of the professional development plan, which means you almost have to approve the calendar, which was my evil plan all to begin with. What you will see, we tried to improve on the calendars this year because last year, remember, we had two calendars, and I know people said their refrigerators got clogged, and we didn't want to do that. So it's all on one calendar. You have a start date, and I'll talk about the start date in a minute, of faculty starting on Tuesday the 6th and school opening on the 7th. You have three early release days in September. We put the total number of days in the upper right-hand corner of each month, so you know how many school days. I'm just walking you through this. You have three early release days in October. November is always a strange month. You only have two early release days because November 8th, which is also voting day, is a full professional development day. We do half day. We have speaker coming in, but we also have parent-teacher conferences on the elementary level. You have no school on Veterans Day, and then we close school for the Thanksgiving recess on the 24th. December, you have three early release days. You have your Christmas break. January, there's two early release days. February, there are three with your February break. March, we do heavy duty early release, there's five. April, there are two with your April, or three with your April break, and there's one in May. We end May 5th for our last early release day. Now, as you know, for the past number of years, probably about six or seven, we have done before starts on before Labor Day starts, which would have been for this year, August 31st, and the kids would come on the 1st and 2nd. As you also know, we have a multi-million dollar roof project in Deerfield. The builders and architects feel that they can complete the project within 10 weeks. However, it would be lovely to have a contingency of an 11th week. Mm-hmm. Because we had so few snow days this year, we are getting out on June 14th. Construction starting on June 20th, that following Monday. I'm hoping that they complete it within 9 weeks, which they could. However, because I need to plan for this, and because it's only a 3-day difference, I decided that I would propose to you to do a start after Labor Day for this year only. Now, I have heard from a number of teachers that they're not happy with that, and I understand that. But I also understand that we have a brand new superintendent coming who would love to have all five schools for opening day to address them. If I have different start times for Deerfield Elementary and the four other schools, I don't think that's a great way to start the year. I also do not have a contingency within the busing contract because we would have to add on three additional days at the end of the year to support the Deerfield buses. That would be about $2,500. I don't have that anywhere in the budget. There aren't a lot, but I also have some shared staff who work in Deerfield and other buildings. I didn't think for those three additional days late that it warranted doing two different calendars and two different starts. So the proposal I have for you this year is a start after Labor Day, 3 days later than we normally would start, and then go back to the pre-Labor Day start in the following year. And that's what this calendar reflects. It reflects that on the elementary as well as the secondary level.
Bill?
You stated that you're aware that there's some that still want the first to start the first in the other three schools, I suppose.
Well, other four schools.
The other four schools. Could you state a little bit about what the reasoning was and why?
Well, I think we've gotten into the habit of, this year was a lovely example, okay? This year we had a start where teachers came back on a Wednesday, I think it was this year, and then we had kids for 2 days, and then they went away for a weekend. And then the following week, I think I had a long weekend because Labor Day, the way it fell, it was just, remember I came to you and I said, this will probably never happen again. And Mr. Decker said, oh, it will never happen again. But but they had, you had a 4 day weekend. You had a Friday and then the Monday Labor Day. And that is a nice way to transition, I get it, for kids and teachers into the summer. It wasn't my brilliant idea. It was simply the way the calendar fell and the way Labor Day fell. So that was some of their questioning. And I understand that, but I also think that having teachers come on one day and just having kids for 3 days is still a bit of a transition. And you get an extra long summer.
For this year.
And I don't know what next year's weather is going to be like. I mean, I can't, predict the future.
And that's the problem with the roof. We don't know if it's going to be a rainy summer. And rainy summers could prolong the need for, rainy days could prolong the need for that 11th week if we can't complete due to rain.
So, sorry.
Are there any collective bargaining issues with changing the dates?
No.
I move it to Frontier.
I have a move for Frontier. Do I have a second?
Second.
Kenny?
Union 38, do I have a motion?
So moved.
Jan? And a second? Elaine? Okay.
In further discussion, I was not texting. This will be a... I was looking up... The state of Massachusetts recognizes Christmas because it falls on the Monday on Monday, but I had been told that it was possible that the state of Massachusetts will take Friday off. I just tried looking it up. It doesn't appear. I couldn't find it anywhere really quick. So that would be my only concern, was that the 23rd right now of December is slated to be a half a day. Mm-hmm. And so it might possibly change and be a full day off.
Why
or it may
Monday?
Not be an issue.
They never do.
I'm just telling you what I was told.
Because it's on a Sunday?
It's on a Sunday, the Monday holiday.
The state calendar, if you go on the state website, will say if the holiday lands on Saturday,
right, and that's what
Friday
I was trying
will
to
be
get
the holiday.
Correct.
And if it lands on Sunday, Monday will be the
correct.
Holiday.
But I'm just sharing what I heard.
Okay.
And so I just wanted to bring that forth, that when we vote on this, hopefully there won't be a change.
I don't know, because we looked it up.
Okay.
Yeah. And if it's on a Sunday, it's Monday is the holiday. Yes. So
good enough for me. Okay, anyone else?
Anything else out there?
Okay, so for Frontier, hearing none. All those in favor? Unanimous. Okay, Ken.
Thank you.
And for the union, all voting members in favor? Opposed? It's unanimous. Welcome.
We're here for discussion.
Okay.
You're
you want him to sing?
Yes. Please.
Okay. We got it.
So moving along to the school committee calendar.
School committee calendar, Lynn may want to change this, but we followed pretty much what we did this year. That's why at the very top in the center it says subject to change. But I included the two joint meetings in October and April. You had more joint meetings this year than you normally do because you hired a superintendent and that required some additional meetings. So I think next year the ebb and flow will be more normalized. So there's really no major changes here. I have I know that Conway and Whately did some lovely agreements to meet together to try to minimize the number of nights that I was out. However, next year, Lynn won't have policies and she won't have any contracts. So she may, I don't know, it's up to you when you get here, Lynn, if you want to talk to the school committees. But this is basically the calendar that we have followed.
Bob? You know, I'd just like to say, I really like the joint meetings. You get to see some people that you haven't seen for a while. Mm-hmm. I mean, granted, this is a lot for tonight to go through as a joint meeting, but even if Louise and Sarah have to come and speak about something, if there's three or four things, I'd rather see more joint meetings. That way, everybody's not out different nights. We're all together and we get it done.
They're great, but I will tell you, for our bookkeepers who have to produce warrants for all five, it is a nightmare. All the warrants have to be produced at the same amount of time. And if you wanted to do it on top of regular monthly meetings and not have any warrants presented, that would be a different story. But from the bookkeeper's perspective, a lot of work to do this.
I just think sometimes when, if Sarah has to go to all five to do a presentation, or Louise, you know, if we could try to group some more of those together as a joint meeting,
yeah.
I think that's...
In October, don't forget, yeah. That's when we have all the presentations. So I've already lined up, Lynn, so you're aware of this. Scott Paul will be doing his annual presentation on technology updates. And we usually always have Sarah and Louise talk about curriculum updates. We try to do that at a joint meeting so that they don't have to come out five times and do the same.
Right.
And so, you know, in April we do policies and calendar and things like that.
Can you sign the warrants like we do in the summer? Like have them in the town hall and go in and sign?
I'm going to turn that to Patty. The likelihood of us getting the requisite number of signatures in a timely manner is pretty slim.
I mean, it's hard getting everybody together in the summer. It's, we could, I'm not saying we can't try it. We would still have to have them prepared on the same, you know, we would probably push to have them prepared for the same time, you know, so that we could get done what we could get done.
Judy?
Are we going back to the 7 o'clock start time?
No.
I know, but it says it on the thing. That's why I brought it up.
Oh, good catch.
Oh, man, good catch.
Sorry, man.
6 o'clock, just like Whately.
Okay, 6 o'clock. Well.
Well, if you had your wish, it would have been 5:30.
It would have been.
I would have done 5:30.
Not everybody is at 6, though.
Yeah.
No, I know. I'm just saying.
No, so 6 o'clock is
Frontier
fine.
Who has 6 and who does 7?
Who has 6? Frontier has 6.
Whately.
Does Whately has 6? Does yeah. Deerfield?
No.
7. No.
7? How about Conway?
7.
No, we're not willing.
Have you discussed it?
We're not willing. We may be willing.
Oh, okay. So you might want to discuss it.
In Sunderland, that's 7.
I will tell you, since we started this, we haven't had a 6 o'clock
not
meeting
a single
yet.
One.
It's been joint and all that kind of crazy stuff. Whately, but we're hoping.
Yeah.
It's worked out well.
Yeah, it's worked out well in Whately.
It's just easier to get out a little earlier.
Also hasn't happened.
So that would be subject to change.
That's right.
Thank you, Lynn. Thank you, Judy. Sorry. Yes. Bob?
Good question. Joint meeting is scheduled to get over 7 o'clock, correct?
Okay.
And we've got 15 minutes to stovepipe all of the Frontier activities. Mm-hmm. I don't really think that's enough time to sit there and talk about everything we need to talk about. And that's the only thing I don't like about the combined meeting is we don't get to focus on our regular stuff. It's bang, bang, slam, bang.
I do purposely keep the individual school committee meetings agendas very short. So in other words, the only thing you have on the Frontier in the elementary meetings is school choice. That's the only item you have other than your warrants and reports.
Yeah, but it's still, to do that 15 minutes, it's pretty fast.
It is.
I mean, we do it but I just don't think...
Well, actually, we haven't. We've never kept to our time schedule,
but,
so that...
But the point is, I just don't like to be able not to be tied to that limited amount of time.
It's a suggested time because...
But that's because you're on Frontier. If you're on all the other school committees who have to wait till Frontier finishes, now you're talking about them staying till 8, 9 o'clock.
Well, we did this a couple years ago, and we ran simultaneously.
The elementary, once we finish Frontier, but we do Frontier first.
Because people from the elementaries are on Frontier, so you wouldn't have a quorum if everybody broke up.
Well, anyway, that's
so, Bob, if you feel like I'm rushing you...
No,
you
may say something, and I will.
Hey, Bob. Bob, you can come to one of our weekly meetings sometime. We can show you how it's
going. Okay, listen, moving along.
Of those 15 minutes, you just took two of them, you know.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Okay, I need a motion from Frontier for the school committee calendar.
We have a
second?
Second.
We have multiple seconds. Pick one, Eric. Okay, Kenny.
I think you have eight.
And the union, a motion? And second?
Second.
Jamie Isler.
Any further discussion? For Frontier, hearing none. All those in favor? Opposed? We're good.
For the union, all in favor? Opposed? It's unanimous.
Okay, we're at the policies. Yeah. Okay, moving on to D, E, and F, policies A, B, and C.
Okay, so you have before you those three sections. As you know, our past practice has always been to give you policies 1 month. You go away, you read them, you come back, and we vote the next month. The reason I didn't do that is because we now have a policy subcommittee, and we have been meeting twice a month since October. We are your eyes and ears. We have reviewed every single policy in the book. We are now meeting next week on the last section, which is policy section J. As you know, this is tedious work, but it's important work. So I have members of the policy subcommittee here tonight. I don't know if you want to chime in and say anything, but I am asking you to understand that we took all of our policies, that thick policy book, we took all of the MASC policies, and we combined those with all the legal references so that by the time I leave, you will have an up-to-date policy book that is online and accessible. You can search by keywords. Anyone can do that. And it is going to be more meaningful. We have also extracted from that a procedure book, because many of our policies were actually procedures. So we will be legal and up to date. So I'm asking you to approve these three sections. I hope to bring you all of the sections between now and June. Robert.
Typically, the policies we have was proposed side by side to what the existing. So we can actually sit down.
That's what the policy subcommittee did.
That's the policy subcommittee. What I'm saying is when I approve it, I want to make sure what existed before and what we're doing now.
I think you have to trust the fact that we...
The policy subcommittee.
Pardon?
I said then Bob can join the policy
subcommittee. Well, we've had a very good working membership, and we have a... person from MASC and attorneys who direct us. We are not doing this in a vacuum, just five or six of us sitting down.
Do you say you're going to bring another policy in a June meeting?
I'm going to bring some in May and then some in June.
So can we tentatively pack this time subject to review in between, and then we can, if we don't bring it back up, it stays?
Bob, when you have a finance subcommittee, and they look at the budgets ahead of time. They take the time to review them ahead of time. They bring a recommendation to the full committee. These are your elected officials. I would hope that you would trust their judgment that they have already vetted this for you. Mr. Skrosky.
I trust
my colleagues that worked on the policy committee. They did their job and their homework, and I will move that the union pass these three policy sections.
Who was the second? Was that Lane?
Do you know if these three sections are already online?
No, they are not online.
They're not online.
No, okay.
It won't be online until we're completely finished.
Yeah.
And no, we're not printing hard copies.
Well, I was going to say.
I did bring four extra copies.
I meant the entire.
Oh, entire policy. So I just wanted to say
to the. I did. I handed it to him.
Joint committees. We're talking about something on the order of 200 to 300 separate policies in sections A, B, and C.
Correct.
As a reasonable matter, you would not want that all put before you tonight to look through side by side.
No, because literally, we've been doing this since October. Mm-hmm. Hours.
Of course, first night, Marty brought cookies, so that made the first night a lot better.
Marty
has brought cookies the rest of the time, so it's been...
It's only been
Greg
cold
and
drops ever since then.
I think we got one more, too, so...
Did you make them yourself, or did you
keep
them? No, she bought them at, Stop and Shop or somewhere like that.
He says with disapproval, Stop and Shop
Judy and Greg.
It's actually BJ's.
Oh, there you go.
We have a motion and a second.
Mary, hold on, we got something. Let me just make a motion for Frontier. Can I have a motion for Frontier?
Motion.
Julie, could I have a second?
Second.
Yep. Okay, now for the discussion.
All I'm going to say is, if it were a simple matter of change from change to, that would actually be much easier to present the two side by side. What actually happened was many of the policies from NASC got compared with the ones that we had, and there was some question whether they overlapped, or was the NASC one easier. And in some cases, we picked one, some people picked the other. In some cases, we cut and paste. So, like, to go from the new, like, that would be a very confusing pile to look at.
Yeah, our members are Greg and Ira and Bob and Alan and
Mary.
Judy.
Not Mary.
Mary, I'm sorry. And they have been diligent. This is a very thankless task that your committee has elected and continued to do. So I thank them profusely.
And I would echo those thanks because I find the process of going in monthly to have a policy presented, go in the following month to vote it, can become very tedious. And to me, it's much more practical to have a subcommittee review what the state and MASC are recommending or requiring, and having it come forward as a packet that's been put together by a group that's willing to take this on. The binders, as you know, well now, the files, as you know, are, I don't know if they're thousands of pages now or hundreds,
yeah.
But it's unbelievable.
Bill?
And there's a team dynamic that's been formed, too. I mean, we saw it with our school committee search, that we had a team that brought us the information. We would have been here for days, mm-hmm. all looking at the same information. So I do appreciate that team dynamic.
Bob?
It's the section on the regional agreement. That's a condensed version. That's not the whole agreement.
No, it's not the whole agreement. But this is a policy book.
But it's not the whole agreement.
It's not the whole agreement, no.
But I think what we're saying, Bob, is that...
I hear what you're saying, Sydney.
We're putting our trust in those people, like I put my trust in you for certain things.
Well, my question is,
but
if we go through this and find something, are we going to have a problem bringing it back
no,
to the table?
You can
absolutely not.
Bob, this is a living document. Since
absolutely
the time
not.
That we got these... I have gotten updates that I now need to add to the sections we haven't even brought to you yet. Because the state is always changing the law, and then MASC is always interpreting the policy. This is always going to be evolving.
Are there any broad changes from the existing policy that we have?
The biggest change was that most of your current policy book was procedural. And it listed step by step by step what you should do. A policy should be very short, it should be large, and it should be fully encompassing. And then you should have your procedures. That's the biggest change in this whole thing.
However, I do thank you for your concern. I think it's great that you
do question it. I really do think that that's wonderful. And again, as long as it's a living document and we can bring it up anytime we want,
yep.
I think we go forth and trust the committee.
I think Lynn owes Marty some cookies for getting this done. Most people realizing they were going to retire would have dodged this and been like, ah,
actually, we like brown.
I don't want to deal with that crap. So, Marty, good job.
Thank you.
A corner of the house, it would have been easy just to let the cobwebs gather.
Oh, yes.
Somebody's got their hand up.
Gregory?
All I was going to say is, once that's put online and in the streamlined form, it'll actually be much easier to bring up to a specific one and get it changed.
Right, yeah.
And I wouldn't ask you to trust again. You know, going forward, once they're online, yeah, you definitely do a piecemeal like this, one at a time. But it's just that one crunch of getting MASC and this online.
Mm-hmm.
I moved the question already.
And did somebody second it?
Yep. Alan made the motion. I seconded it. We did all three.
Yeah.
All three of us.
Are we going to do all three at once, Ken?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So
I took it as a blanket.
Yeah.
Did you get your motion?
That was Don's motion, right?
Did you make his motion? Yes, Don made his motion. Okay. So for Frontier, we're going to do all A, B, and C all at once. So all I can do a roll call. Okay, Judy Pierce.
Yep.
Keith McFarland?
Yes.
Bob Decker?
Yeah.
Phil Cantor?
Yes.
Mary Raymond?
Yes.
Bob Halla?
Yep.
Alan Lipp?
Yeah, I could bring it up anytime.
William Marapizzi?
Yes.
Cindy Womet? Yes. Thank you.
I can bring it up anytime. That's what they told me.
The union will do a roll call.
We're going to start throwing things at me.
I got three here.
Hey, you got to go back. Yes. Jameson?
I guess.
David?
Yes.
Jan?
Yes.
Elaine?
Yes.
Ira?
Yes.
Gregory?
Yes.
Keith?
Yes.
Don?
Yes.
Katie?
Yes.
Bob?
You can have this back.
Bob?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Unanimous. Thank you all.
Okay, moving on to the superintendent's report.
Yes, it's a two-item, very short report. I'm not even going to read it. It's in your pile. Read it at your leisure. However, one thing I would like to quickly acknowledge that we have two members here who may not realize this is their last school committee meeting, and that's Jamie Isler and Alan Lipp. Alan has served on the Frontier School Committee since 2012, and Jamie's been on Deerfield since 2010. You will, both gentlemen, get lovely plaques that will be delivered to you, commemorating your service. Both of these guys live in Deerfield, and both are educators, more retired educators, have been very thoughtful and their deliberations. I always thought of both of you that you didn't talk a lot, but when you did, I listened, because you both generally said things that were very important. So, we have appreciated your speech. Always said things that were important. So anyway, we appreciate your service. You'll have some leisure time. And
you can always come to
lovely parting gifts.
Thank you.
Yeah, lovely parting gifts. So thank you guys very much.
Okay, we have no executive session, so Ken from Frontier, can I have a motion to adjourn?
So made.
Second?
You have it.
And then we sort of sit here because we're going to do the Frontier meeting.
But we can leave.
Kenny?
Motion from the union.
So moved.
Second?
What was adjourned? I didn't hear a second.
Second?
What's that? Who said it? Okay, thanks, Steve.
Okay, from Frontier, no further discussion. Unanimous, we're out of here.